Get started. This is the first SDP talk of the new year, beginning July 1st. Sorry for the short notice. We expected that maybe there wouldn't be a party, but nobody would come. I think it's going to be a party, and obviously a few people have come. Very brief introduction. You know what? Steve is someone who did what many of us thought when we were growing up, at least. Many of us grew up on things like Tom Swift books. And then there was a wonderful magazine called The Open Road for Boys. You got this very sexist by present terms, but you get the flavor of it. It suggested all kinds of horizons and so on. And if you mix those two, and you had phototelephones and other kinds of wonderful things that were then imagined, and the open road, you'd have what Steve has become. So without any further ado, Steve Roberts.
Well, thanks. It's good to be here. First time in Boston in years. I found out that one of the reasons I don't like to ride around Boston is it took about 10 or 15 minutes to get across two this morning. Anyway, actually, Wally's kind of right. I've had this lifelong fascination with technology and adventure and merging art and engineering and all these sorts of things that cross traditional boundaries. And in 1983, I found myself through an obscure train of events that doesn't really matter, living in Columbus, Ohio, and that inspires long-distance travel, so good. I'd fallen into a pattern that's actually fairly familiar to a lot of people. I was doing things that I didn't enjoy anymore, trying to pay for something that I didn't want after all. I had turned my hobbies into a business, and I had bought a house in suburbia. And, you know, I was working harder and harder at something I didn't like, trying to pay for something I didn't like. And after a few years of this, it sort of slowly sunk in, like, wait a minute, this is really stupid behavior. Why am I doing this? I'm going to spend my whole life this way. And, you know, the normal pattern is you end up sort of collecting money in order to pay for overhead and hoping there's a little bit of time and money left over for the things you really want, which get crammed into weekends and evenings and holidays and eventually retirement. Anyway, I'm just too impatient for all that. So I set out a list of my passions and decided that I'd try to construct a lifestyle out of them. And they were basically travel and adventure, romance, computers, networking, ham radio, bicycles, publishing, learning. You know, I stared at the list for a while, oh, well, obviously I'll just sell my house in suburbia, build a high-tech bicycle with computers and radios aboard, and move to it, and write about it as I go. So I did. In 1983, I built the Winnebago, which was the first version of this. I didn't name it until I was in Lake Livingston, Texas. I had just done a CBS Morning News filming, and they finally left me alone, and I got this quiet corner of a campground, and I was all settled in and stirring Camp Glapola and my little firebomb, and this big motorhome pulled in right next to me. I was like, no other neighbors for 10 or 15 campsites. And it sat there with the engine running and fired up the generator, and it ran for a while, and then I hear this zzzz as the satellite dish went up. Clunk as the hydraulic step went down, and then finally the door opened, and this very large person started backing down the steps, wrestling with this thing that with green tubing and wheels and cables, and I was trying to see around and see what it was. It was a lawnmower. And he mowed the grass around this campsite. Later he explained that, you know, he likes to come up from Houston on weekends, which is 50 miles south, and have some adventure. I mean, so anyway, I named this the Winnebago, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Anyway, I built this bike and carried a laptop computer, which at the time was the Radio Shack Model 100, terribly exciting thing in 1983. I lived on CompuServe and hit the road. And it took off. I did about 10,000 miles solo, which took about a year and a half. And that led to this book called Computing Across America. I have a few copies here, but hopefully not enough. Anyway, I had tons of adventures. I mean, just encounters with convicts in the Maryland woods and romances of all descriptions, and just all kinds of wonderful things happened. Unfortunately, as a freelance writer, I discovered that living on a bicycle was no magical cure for bad work habits. It was still PFD. Procrastination followed by despair. So I was in somewhere in West Texas, and it occurred to me that if I get three octaves out of a flute, I should be able to get the alphabet out of my fingers. I mean, there's 256 combinations, even if you only use eight of them. So I built a keyboard into the handlebars, and this sort of that idea launched the Winnebago 2, which was on the road then from about 86 to 88 or something like that. And there was a control console with, it was encrusted with switches and lights. It was far too complicated. It had a RadioShack Model 100 built into the console this time, because by then I was very used to hacking it. It was very easy to interface. And I had this little binary keyboard, and I typed in ASCII. So the low 5 bits of the ASCII character were these fingers. As you should.
Well,
it was, where do you put a QWERTY keyboard on a bicycle? So I actually, I could do about 30 words a minute on that thing. And so I met a woman named Maggie. I was in a jazz bar one night with an HP Portable Plus about midnight drinking a beer, and she wondered what I was doing with a computer in a bar. And I said, you want to see my bicycle? And 2 weeks later, I said, do you want to go for a bike ride? And she said, okay. And I said, good, quit your job, sell your car, trash your lifestyle, get a recumbent and a ham license, and we'll leave in 6 months. So so we did both coasts together, the Pacific Coast, and then also sort of from Ohio again, because, well, see, we did the Pacific Coast and got stuck in Palo Alto. And the problem is, once you're there, it's really hard to go anyplace else. Not that Palo Alto's that great or anything, it's really rather boring, but west is into the water, and north is into the wind, and east is through the deserts, and south is toward L.A., so you just stay. So we packed our bikes in a truck and took off and went to Columbus, Ohio, and we're on the road within a week. So anyway, all of that went well, and I was writing stories and getting books out and having great fun, and the problem became technological. I mean, the Winnebago 2 was really boring technologically. I mean, it was architecturally inflexible. Every time I wanted to make a change, I was editing with a soldering iron instead of a screen editor. So I decided to build Behemoth. And that after doing a school bus tour around the country, I finally started this project, which is why I'm going to tell you about it. There. So now that we're here, and for the last 3.5 years I've been doing this thing. Its name is Behemoth. Did the flyer tell the acronym? What it stands for? It's Big Electronic Human Energized Machine, only too heavy. Its power to weight ratio is about the same as a fully loaded tractor trailer rig with a 12 horsepower lawnmower engine. So that's why it has 105 speeds and disc brakes. There are 3 derailleurs, you know, so I've got a very wide gearing range. I can go up very steep hills. See, in normal mode, I just push this button and the landing gear retract. And so that's why I'm on the road, but if I get to a really steep hill and need to slow down, then I just drop those things, put in a low gear, and then I can go infinitely slowly, including stop, which is useful, because this is really heavy. It's 580 pounds fully loaded. In that mode, the solar panels are a little bit convex because it's full of packs. The gravity is a bit of a problem, actually. I was going up a steep hill last summer in Wisconsin, southern Wisconsin, and I was about halfway up the steep gravel hill. It was the end of the day. It was the entrance to a campground. It was no longer than this room. And suddenly I lost traction. I had the landing gear down. I was in my granny gear, and everything's fine, except every time you push the pedals, the wheel would just spin in the gravel. Well, I can't go forward anymore. I obviously can't go back. And I couldn't go to either side. So I was kind of sitting here going, waiting for an airlift, you know? And all of a sudden, the disc brake from hell unscrewed. And that was the thing that was holding me. So the whole thing was tumbling backwards down the hill, completely out of control, until it jackknifed and went down, pinning me to the ground, because my feet were still locked in the pedals. So now this thing's got my thigh slammed against the ground, and now I'm stuck. You know how embarrassing it is to be trapped under your bicycle? The words don't go well together. But anyway, those are the bad times. There are also a lot of good times. I really haven't done much actual real road time on this, only about 1,000 miles or so since I built it, after 3.5 years, getting it on the road was a sort of major rollout. But I did a shakedown cruise through the Midwest, and then I got on this mothership tour going around visiting companies and things. So I'm kind of trying to get back to the road, but I'll get to that in a minute. But it has some really funny things have happened before I get into the technology. Last summer, I was cruising along in Iowa with a stereo. I've got a CD player in here. Talk to me. Carry about 140 discs. So I'm cruising along, I've got the helmet cooler running, because the heat is crazy. Sounds great, and this really helps on the hills. It's even better than gears. The heat exchanger in the helmet that pumps ice water through the helmet liner. Cool's good. I'll tell you more about that in a second. Okay, something on the Macintosh here. And it's a So I'm just cruising along, comfortable, cool, relaxed. It's about 95 degrees out, and the cyclist came zipping up beside me. He's all lycra and silver and all everything. And he looked down at me for a moment and he goes, "Pardon me, do you have any gray poupon?" Anyway, oh, one other anecdote. Just one more. I was in Seattle last summer, and I was hungry, and I had on these mirrored sunglasses, which I lost someplace recently. But I pulled up to the drive-in window of a Taco Bell. And remember the mirrored glasses, right? So this whole thing is this very old kind of thing. And the woman behind the counter looked kind of startled. And so I just looked at her for a moment and I said, give me a burrito, resistance is futile. While I have this in my hand, I guess I should start telling you about the bike. This is the brain interface unit. It's first of all, it's responsible for cooling. If I remember, I'll pull out the cap and show you. It's this neat little heat exchanger built by Life Support Systems, originally for NASA, and now race car drivers and other people use it. There's a heads-up display here, the little private eye for reflection technology, which I know you're quite familiar with here. An audio system, a boom microphone, and two speakers, all waterproof, so like police motorcycle stuff. Obviously, if I want to feel lightheaded, all I have to do is throw a switch. And then there's these three ultrasonic sensors here so that I can control the cursor on the Macintosh screen by just moving my head around. And actually, I'm not really that pleased with them. I'm getting some phase jitter problems, mostly because of this capacitor here. So the company called Gyration just came out with these really nice little tiny gyroscopes, and that's coming. So I think I'll get rid of these and put on a little gyroscope module to generate phase quadrature for head movement. And then I just got an absolutely magical little TV camera about this big, and that will go right there because I'm doing some amateur television and also taking still video images with the Spark Station and sending them through the net. But I'm getting ahead of myself again. The console, the main screen here is a Macintosh portable, which was very easy to use. And really the idea there is to be able to have total control over everything on the bike with a nice graphic user interface. So at the control level, every device has an address on a power bus. Everything has its own little dedicated FET switch and its own little dedicated switching regulator made by Powertrans. Everything that has, for which serial communication is relevant, has an address on a serial crosspoint matrix. That's my onboard network. And there's an onboard audio network. So there are three boards, one on each site, that each of which talks to the 8 audio long lines and can handle any of 16 inputs and 16 outputs. So all you have, these are the Mitel 8816 crosspoint switch chip. It's quite cool. So anyway, all you have to do then from the Macintosh in a HyperCard graphic user interface is say, well, I want to connect the speech synthesizer to the cellular phone, and now the speech synthesizer can talk on the phone. The reason that's useful, by the way, and the nice thing about this whole idea of having everything on here just strictly be software from the perspective of writing the control system, every device, every piece of hardware is nothing but an addressable node. GPS receiver, stereo, everything except safety stuff like lights, basically, is just on the net. I think it's nice about that is that then I can do things that I didn't initially plan on, and it takes a lot less wire to do it. A good example is the security system. When you have something that is estimated at about $1.2 million and tends to attract a lot of people, you worry about it a lot. And I found that my paranoia index is really more of a concern than the actual threat, but still, I worry about it a lot. So there's six levels of sensors. There's a microwave motion sensor here, a little 10 gig motion sensor looking up into a copper cone, so it knows if anybody's within about 10 feet. There's an ungo box that sees this kind of movement, just physical jostling. There's access, the switches on all the access panels, so it knows if anything's being opened. It knows wheel movement, there's a little quadrature sensor there, so it knows which way it goes as well. So it's kind of cool because it'll do a backup beeper too. which also beeps if I'm writing a file to tape, but anyway. one of these days, if I ever get around to it, I'll put a sensor on for a body in the seat, but I don't know if I'll ever get to that. And most importantly, there's a GPS receiver up here. It's a Trimble TANS. There's antennas right on top. And if the latitude and longitude start changing significantly without the right password, then it knows that somebody other than me is moving it. Well, at this point, it's a red alert. So it beeps in with a pocket beeper. It can use the synthesizer to talk locally and set off the siren. It sends beacon on ham radio packet frequencies, giving lat long out to the ham community. Sends a satellite message via the GTE G-Star satellite to San Diego. And then finally dials 911 with a cellular phone. And with a synthesizer says, hello, I'm a bicycle, I'm being stolen. Actually, since I'm back here, the communication, oh, I don't rhyme with this up, by the way, in case you're wondering, that's a bridge detector. This is no mail folded up here. There's a lot of communications here on board. There's a HF ham radio, UHF and VHF ham radio transceivers. I'm really plugged into the ham radio networks as well as internet community. A small TV station, a CD, which is culturally useless, but occasionally kind of handy. And then, probably most important is that my internet connection here, this thing's fun. The idea here, this is a Qualcomm Omnitrax terminal, and it talks to the GTE G-Star satellite. It's a 14 gigahertz uplink and 12 gig down. And when I turn it on, it looks around, acquires the satellite, locks on, and then always stares in that direction, no matter which way the bike points. It occasionally looks off and picks up a tracker satellite, triangulates, and then location stamps all my outgoing email with lat long. So I've got X dash location, and then code at the other end plugs in X dash nearest city, and so on. The thing is, it's very slow, but the thing that's nice about it is that all my high-priority email is now connected to me all the time. So I have a Spark station sitting down in San Diego at the hub, and any incoming piece of mail gets handed to a little task there that decides whether it's important. I mean, well, it doesn't decide that. It decides who, if it's from somebody who I really have on my hot list, and if it's a short piece of email. If so, it goes through the satellite and shows up here. At this end, there's a custom piece of code that interfaces it to Eudora, which is a public domain top client. So the Macintosh sees this as a modem, basically. It's totally transparent from my perspective up there. I can click on a little checkbox and also use the cellular phone modem. I have a cell blazer that from Telebit that plugs in the cellular phone, and also, of course, all the usual things that plug in people's modular phone jacks, which is always the first choice because it's free. Let's see. This needs to get repackaged one of these days. I sort of ran out of time, but this is the bike's heavy-duty machine. I took a Spark Station IPC, repackaged it, it repackaged everything. It's basically just an IPC board. This is Sharp's new TFT Active Matrix Color LCD, which is dazzling. It's blazing color. The display's about $3,000, but I think they're finally starting to get cheaper. It has 424 meg of hard disk, a couple of Connors drives, 16 meg of RAM, and most interestingly, a 9600 baud Motorola ARPANET data link, which is a virtual wire good for about 3 miles. Here's the other end of it. So when I'm away from the bike, I can use the bike as a server. Like, I can haul this thing up a mountain, should I feel completely irrational, and then run PPP on it and make it through the cellular phone back on the bike, make a net connection and download a GIF. So anyway, there's a couple of things. Let me rotate this just a little bit here just to make it easier. See, the Macintosh screen folds up. This is what I call mechanical display paging. underneath there's another one. That's currently a VGA display for DOS, which I find that I never use. It's invisible outdoors, and it's DOS. So DOS, incidentally, can be compared to an upright bicycle, and Mac can be compared to a recumbent. So I'm starting to see that kind of dichotomy. This is a very dangerous thing to say in some crowds, but... Anyway, a couple other things here. There's a little diagnostic panel that lets me look at low-level bit conditions. There's a dedicated microchip PIC processor. All the low-level processors in this thing, three of them are 68 HC11s running fourth, and the Mac sits on top of those. So I've got these little fourth engines everywhere, which, by the way, generate horrible amounts of RF. And then they're the ones that do the dirty work of data collection and power management and things like that. And then the Mac just sits on top of that. Speaking of power, this 72-watt solar panel is the primary source. I can also recharge from AC, and also one of these days, if I ever get to it, the new front wheel is a variable reluctance motor generator. I want to move this back chair under the hood, and then I'll shut up for a minute and take questions. That antenna, by the way, I made a dipole out of a couple of Outbacker whips. They're designed to be vertical antennas to go on vehicles. And the problem with putting an antenna like that on a bicycle is that it expects the vehicle to be the other half of the antenna system, or the counterpoise, which works fine if you have a car or a van or something sitting on the ocean. but on a bicycle it's not so good. So the solution is to take two of them and run them as a dipole, and then that's a nice balanced antenna system. So it works really well. I better not press my luck. Okay. Serviceability was a major design goal. This was a custom fiberglass job. I will never do this again. A lot of work doing this stuff, molding and things like that. All the rest of it, the other fiberglass here, there's the rump, which is, this is the rear unit of many purposes, rump. And then the wazoo back there is the wheeled auxiliary storage unit. Those things are all made out of what I call cellulose core silicon matrix polyester filled composite, which is CSPC. Otherwise, you could describe it as corrugated cardboard put together with a hot glue gun and fiberglass. Works incredibly well. It's very, very cheap and hackable, and is waterproof and light. Oh, here's an essential component. Every bicycle needs an answering machine. What's my message sound like now? Top 10. Here we go. Never mind. Usually it says something like, I'm on the road at the moment, or no, I'm not on the bike at the moment, but the next time I'm back on the road, I'll get your message and call you back. It's all great. the way this works, by the way, is I've got an OP cellular phone back here, and there's essentially a wonderful product called the cell jack from Cellular. And you put it between the handset and the TRU of a cellular phone, and it absolutely simulates a modular phone jack. I mean, it's a perfect replica of your house phone line with all the call progress tones and everything. It does generates ringer current, so you can plug a standard desk phone with a ringer into my bike, and you call it, the phone rings. So that makes it possible to plug in all these phone accessories. So there's a cordless phone and answering machine. All the modems plug in through that, because it's a nice, simple connection. And I have a credit card verifier now, so that when I... This is actually really fun to do. I publish this quarterly magazine called No Madness, which I recommend. And it's $15 a year, and I'll meet people on the street, and they'll say, oh, I'm sorry, I don't have any money. I say, no problem, I take plastic. I used two kinds of CAD system to do this. It started with Prime Medusa with help from a mechanical wizard friend of mine, and then we moved it to AutoCAD. And I didn't really believe it, because I was kind of a newcomer to designing mechanical CAD stuff, so I used the other kind of CAD system called cardboard-aided design and made a model. This really bothers bike shop owners. I have no luck in bike shops.
Wait. Oh. I won't just stand.
Oh, okay. It's new. There's a little hard disk platform here. The Mac is there. I won't run through it because you can't see it anyway. But this is the DOS machine that's actually going to be removed and be replaced by the innards of the Spark there. All the back of the front paddle stuff. Yes, I always wanted to ride a unicycle. And... head mouse controller, speech recognition, the Trimble GPS receiver. Back here is one of those audio cross-point switchboards. That's a 2-meter packet radio. Some of the power switching stuff, speech synthesizer, AmpTor, and some other data modes. And then one other little serviceability hack here, the bicycle control processor has this board on top of it, I call the Nexus board, and it swings down to give me access to the back of these Robinson Engine Quick Connect instead of wire wrap, it's just a little profile. And then that's all the boards for the fourth engine. And it has two subordinates that are sitting back there. So let's see, what have I forgotten? I've probably forgotten all sorts of things, but any questions?
What is the huge antenna for, as opposed to the smaller ones?
Oh, the huge antenna is for HF ham radio. That works 80 through 10 meters in 7 bands. I've talked all over the world while mobile with it. So Japan, really easy on 10 meters, Europe on 20 and 15, and lots of stateside contacts all over the place. Just kind of nice while cruising along to be able to chat with people around the world.
Wait, you can ride with that up, provided you watch the clearances.
No, I never ride with that up. It would be far too unstable. I can ride with it at this level and in vertical dipole mode.
And it'll still work.
That one, yeah. Vertical dipoles are okay too.
Can you use the internet without that up at all?
This has nothing to do with the internet. Okay. This is ham radio. Yeah, the internet is satellite station. This is cellular phone. This is 2 meter and 440 ham radio pager. The RF data link between backpack and bike. There's another little rubber ducky over here that's for an audio link between backpack and bike. It's really fun. This is a license-free wireless intercom, basically. And well, one of the things that I was doing with this for a while, actually, this is on the old bike I did this. It had the same basic functionality of speech and audio. I could take my offline laptop and whatever it is, just any log device, send text to the bike via ham radio packet, and then the little trivial task turns it around and hands it to the speech synthesizer, so it says whatever I sent. And then at the same time, I can hear what's going on around the bike, and I see the implications of this. I could be sitting in a restaurant out of sight, somebody will walk up to it, and the bike will carry on a totally cogent conversation with me. Yeah. I was in Bainbridge Island, Washington. I think it was at the Streamliner Diner, and this little kid came by with a skateboard under his arm. He was maybe 10, 11, something like that. And as he passed, the bike said, "You have a strange bicycle there." And he said, "It's not a bicycle, silly. It's a skateboard." And so the two of them started chatting. And this is and he's really loosening up, and having this whole conversation. And he saw his mom come out of a nearby store. And he said, "Wait right here." So he ran down and ran down the street, grabbed his mom, and kind of dragged her back, and she's kind of bored, like, yeah, sure, flying a bicycle. You know, you just like see her. She's stressed, she's had too much coffee, she's not into it. And the kid's all excited, right? So they get back to the bike and he introduces Mr. Bicycle, who of course doesn't say a word. So she says something to the effect, yeah, I've had it with your lies. Come on, let's get home. It's late. And they got about 3 or 4 steps away. He's almost in tears, and he really looks betrayed. And they get about 3 steps away, and the bike said, "Hi there, pretty girl. Do you want to ride on me?" But she froze in her tracks. Told you. Anyway, next question. Yes?
Cooling system.
Ah. One of the problems with pedaling this monstrous thing on hot days is that I'm not 100% efficient, which is really constantly annoys me. So I tend to overheat a lot, and the body likes to dump heat through the top of your head, and which is fine, except on a bicycle you're also wearing this big insulator. I mean, it's a styrofoam insulator. It's a very effective way to block your cooling. Unfortunately, you need it for other reasons. So the solution, this is the thing, Life Support Systems makes these. And I just put this on. It's a network of tubes in there that are all in a sort of fabric substrate. And it gives me this kind of druid look. These two little CPT fittings here, I think that's what they're called. And they plug into this. I just have this little thing on here as a keeper just to keep the dirt out. And there's a little peristaltic pump down there. Nice low-tech manual pump. So if I want to cool my body, I just give that a little crank for a moment. And it works. I was going up another steep hill in Wisconsin. There's lots of those, it turns out. And this guy was kind of leaning out on his front fence as I went by, smoking his pipe and watching me. And he had lots of time to contemplate my approach. You know? I sort of crept by and nodded. Then he said, "You get much extra power out of that hand crank setup?" Then I realized that wasn't really a stupid question, because when you overheat, you have to derate your body's performance. So actually, the answer is yes. A more common question, of course, is that bicycle solar powered? Because there's these big solar panels here, and people don't know the scale of solar panels. This is a tenth of a horsepower, roughly, which is certainly not going to do the job. Of course, I'm a tenth of a horsepower, and I do the job. So the correct answer to the question is, yes, it is solar powered. I'm part of the food chain. Yes?
What happens in the rain?
I get wet, but skin is waterproof, so it's okay. You're asking, you're more concerned about the equipment, I see.
No.
There's a waterproof cover that just Velcros over the front panel. This ring of Velcro around here is for that. And then that protects the stuff that is absolutely not waterproof. And then everything else already is. I still have this habit of rubber banding a baggie over the private eye, mostly because I'm not convinced that my little attempt at waterproofing is going to work, and I don't want to test it. Everything else already is, and in fact, that thing is totally waterproof. It can sit out in the rain overnight. So I don't make a habit of deliberately going out to ride in the rain, but if I'm stuck in it, it's not a real big problem. Yeah?
What's the black antenna that runs up your flagpole?
Oh, forgot to mention that. That's 2-meter ham radio. I took a 2-meter HT from ICOM and just repackaged it and built it into the console. And it seems a tad redundant, and actually is, but I often ride without the trailer, so it's nice to have a totally offline. In fact, it's not even networked at the moment. Push to talk is dedicated right there, and just make sure I always have a 2-meter grip handy. Using a lot.
What's something like solar cartridge down there for?
That's the air tank. I can recharge it like this. This is old. I do have one of those for tires, but that is what's running the pneumatic system for the landing gears, and also the red button here. Always at a trade show demo, it never fails. I'll be sitting in conversation in somebody's booth or some trade show, and somebody whose curiosity overcomes the natural reticence will push that button. Of course, everybody leaves.
Do you have anything special for cold weather conditions?
I don't have optimum cold weather gear, but I have quite a bit. I have some various bits of Patagonia bunting jackets and shelled things, and in real cold weather, I carry a parka and lots of polypro underwear and all that kind of stuff. So. Good gloves, neoprene gloves.
Are all the box systems rated down to whatever gets down to wherever you go?
Well, yeah, effectively. I haven't really been formal about making sure that all the chip ratings cover the right range, but anything I'm willing to pedal in is probably okay. A larger concern is overheating. In fact, I made a very stupid error on the Winnebago 02. I had a clear Lexan fairing that was free blown, and then underneath that, on the top of the unfolding console, was a solar panel. And of course, this is a greenhouse effect, prescription for greenhouse effect. If I parked it in hot sun, it would get to about 140 degrees, very bad. But this stays really cool. It's all light. Yeah.
You give this the low end for travel and maybe zero. What about really covering distances on the flat? Sort of what do you maintain here?
Well, the other end of the spectrum is with a gravity assist, I've had it to 50.5. With a gravity assist, I've had it up to 50.5. But to answer your question, my normal cruising speed—it depends on my attitude and what I had for breakfast. But it gets about 35 miles per pizza EPA, by the way. I only cruise about 9 to 11 now, and if I'm just kind of lazing along and being comfortable, if I look down, it usually says about 9. So and that's adequate. I'm not in a hurry. Yeah.
What kind of trouble from police do that?
Every now and then, I got harassed in Whiteville, North Carolina, because I was sitting in a payphone with a laptop, an acoustic coupler, and he was livid. He said, I've had 3 calls about you out here messing with this phone. I want to know what you're doing. Who's paying for it? Did you ever try to explain email to a Southern cop? And 3 times I go through the whole explanation. And finally, reluctantly, unable to come up with anything to bust me on, he finally left me alone. But it's crazy. And then in South Hill, Virginia, I got pulled over. Lights and siren, and I'm riding along. The cop's alongside me. And I waved, and he said, So I stopped and I'm not speeding, so. But still there's that same little familiar quaver in the gut, Well, he comes over and he's got his mirrored sunglasses on, his hand and his revolver. And he said, I just want to see what the hell y'all got, yeah? So I had to explain the whole thing.
What are your plans for the future of this?
That's a big one. The embarrassing half of the answer is that I'm probably not going to do massive amounts of bicycle touring now that I've spent 3.5 years and the help of 40 people and 140 sponsors building this thing. I'm a little tired of the road, and not in a metaphorical sense, but the asphalt sense. It's very bumpy, and it has bad drivers and glass and hills and all sorts of other things that it doesn't hold any real surprises for me. I do want to do some international touring, but I'm a little burned out. I'm just wandering around on the bike. So I'm starting the new project, which is, I'm sort of toggling between 2 names. One is Leviathan, which is a variety of acronyms, and the other one is the CMOS Microship. And basically, I'll give you the short form, because I don't want to go into too much detail until it's real, but the idea is to take computerized sea kayak, basically. I was starting with something that looks like about a 20-foot double sea kayak. Cutting it in half, putting in bulkheads so it can fold and turn into a trailer with wheels that deploy, and then have a folding recumbent bicycle that comes out from the unused hatch and tows it. So it's an amphibian. And, you know, it's nice because on water, there are no hills except very temporary ones. And, and there are occasionally bad drivers, and there's hypothermia and all this other stuff. I mean, you know, it can kill you just as easily, probably more easily, but on the other hand, I really like it. So it's time to do something different. So I'm in the process of just launching that project now. I'm going down to North Carolina to pick up my training kayak and start all the glass work on the big one while I head out west and pursue it in more detail. What I'm doing is defining mission-critical subsystems on here. What do I really need? How much of it can be folded into a single processor, how much of the communication stuff is redundant, how much is necessary, what else do I have to add for navigation, and so on. And then throw it all in a single hermetically sealed package, pressurized with dry nitrogen, so if it leaks, we don't have it breathing in salt water. And then drop it into a central hatch, and then tile the whole deck with solar panels. So, why are you laughing? This is perfectly reasonable.
Yeah. You've mentioned about 5 sponsors. What do the other 135 get for their sponsorship?
Well, I'll mention them now. well, a lot of it is exposure. I've had quite a bit of publicity. In fact, oh, that reminds me. This is slightly embarrassing, but it should be fun. I'm doing the Donahue show. I've already filmed it. I'm the only guest. It's a whole hour, and it should air on July 23rd. That's in the same day markets and the secondary markets within a couple days after that. You mentioned a number of companies' names there, so I don't know how the Donahue market will respond to mentions of Spark Stations and things. But and People Magazine, and you know, there's a bunch of this kind of stuff. Wall Street Journal front page. It mentions Apple and Sun, and you know, and all these things. And this here's a typical one. And QST, this ham radio journal, and all the different ham radio systems were mentioned. And the thing, the generalization of all of that is that and I don't ever fly people's decals. I don't ever fly flags or anything like that. Nobody pays me to use their stuff. And so from the media's perspective, recommendations that I make or comments about why I chose particular pieces of hardware are very honest. And I decide what will be the very best possible solution to this problem. And I go to that company and try to acquire it. And so everybody wins. So the media gets an ongoing story that changes, and it's a story that doesn't have a lot of PR fluff built into it. So all that plus engineering feedback, because I'm putting a lot of engineering work into this and then taking it out and using it in a bizarre context that's kind of almost like a caricature of normal applications. So things get abused much more heavily here than they typically do in normal environments. And I do a lot of feedback to companies and so on.
What about other kinds of scale-off? I'm thinking, for example, you've got your GPS system, presumably map software and so forth that will tell you where you are, where you're going, and how to get there. There are any number of things on this bike that would seem to be quite reasonable on an automobile or any other kind of conveyance. And I'm wondering, do you have any kind of feedback in the other direction toward the industry? And,
very much so. Yeah, in fact, Ben Franklin once he turned down a patent for the Franklin stove that the governor of Pennsylvania offered him, and he said something to the effect that, you know, as we benefit from the inventions of others, it's our duty to share our inventions and so on. And in the altruistic sense, I kind of have that attitude because people have helped me so much that to then take all the product of all these people's wizardry and then go off and market it would change the flavor of the whole thing and probably make people less willing to keep on giving me time and equipment. On the other hand, there are a lot of interesting spin-offs, and I'd really like to find a joint venture partner of some sort to take the things that look like they have product potential, do a little analysis and find out which ones really do and which ones are just neat, and then run with the two or three promising ones. One in particular, this audio cross-point switching network, that was something I designed and built for this and had boards made and everything. And there's nothing like it on the market. It's real low power and lets you just take an arbitrary number of audio devices and connect them to each other any way you like under software control. And, you know, that's a product. So one of these days, I certainly don't want to clone the entire bike. I've actually been asked that a few times, whether I'm going to market these. Yes, it comes with about a 10-month training school that you have to go to. But yeah, it's a good question. It's an issue I haven't totally dealt with yet. So, yeah.
How do you count the 105 speeds? I only count 7 8.
Oh, it's a five by three by seven matrix.
Five by three.
The reason you missed it is the grain gear on this side is very tiny. I use something called a limbo spider, which lets you take a cog and use it instead of a chain ring. So my granny chain ring is 13 teeth instead of the usual 26. So that's even.
What is your HF radio and what's your call sign?
The HF radio is an ICOM 725, and call sign is M4RVE. This translates into Nomad for Recumbent Vehicle Escapades. the nice thing about the ICOM is that it's got the CIV interface, and I can run it from heads-up display or wherever. It's kind of a fun thing to operate while mobile. The UHF and VHF rigs aren't interfaceable or aren't remote controllable yet. But yeah.
I saw four different gear shifts. Yet they're only being the three different gear.
The fourth one is a parking brake. That's a serious problem. This thing weighs a lot, and if I park it on even the most subtle grade, it wanders off. And for years, I put up with this stupid strip of Velcro, and I would Velcro it around a brake lever, and always muttering at this kludge. And I said, "Wait a minute, why don't we just add a parking brake?" It was like, you know, a 1 hour job. You know, it's just one of those things that the new brake. If I ever get around to it, like I said, if I move to the kayak, I won't need this, but.
What I say?
The new front wheel is actually partly done. A company called Semifusion in Morgan Hill is working on it, and it's a variable reluctance motor generator, half horsepower, that is the front wheel hub. And basically this variable reluctance motor is this sort of universal interface between shaft position and software in both directions. You can make a motor, a stepper, a generator, a parking brake, anything you want out of it, just with the phase angle and amplitude that you give it. And it's all digital. It's really fun. And so some of the things you can do with that, of course, is use it as a brake, decode the dead band. As I start to squeeze this lever, proportionally pull power out of the wheel and throw it in the charge bus as my first line of braking, which is good because I don't currently have enough braking. Use it as a motor. If I want to just take the 72 watts there and throw it at it, it would be like adding about another half person without the extra weight. Use it as a parking brake, let the thing sit there like that, and use just little bits of energy to hold it in one spot. But it doesn't take energy to hold it in one spot unless you try to move it away from it, which adds the possibility of having the bike just sit there, and if somebody rolls it, it gets harder and harder to roll. And it lets go, and it rolls itself back. And it's like, another example of why it's fun. I've done all this in software, because the silly ideas, you know, if done as a whole custom system would be just ridiculous amounts of effort for the return, but it's often just a few lines of code to add something goofy. But, yeah.
What are your speech recognition capabilities and what do you use it for?
Speech recognition is very minimal right now. I just have the Kovox and I'm not even using it. It's way too slow for connected speech. My plan was to use it for some voice commands like, you know, get mail, those kinds of things. I'm finding the handlebar keyboard so easy I surely don't need it, so it hasn't been in use. I am interested in any of some speech recognition system that does do connected speech, but at the moment they all require too much of a processor to leave on all the time. So one of these days, there's an awful lot of output that goes from my brain into the machine when I'm rolling. And it is kind of irritating to have to do it all with the keyboard. In fact, in the kayak, that's a big issue because I don't want a paddle keyboard. The relationship with the paddle is much more dynamic than the relationship with the handlebars. And so that really raises a problem for me because I don't know how to type while paddling just yet.
Can you say a bit more about the analog keyboard? You said originally those were the ASCII bits.
Yes. Oh, okay. This is now the InfoGrip system. I was getting to the point where I wanted to talk to the Mac and the DOS with it, and rather than once again invent this, you know, this keyboard hack, Ward Bond in Louisiana had just come out with this thing to plug right into a DOS machine. So I went with that, and now they have a chip that'll do both DOS and Mac. You just toggle the command line. It's a little microcontroller. And the nice thing is it's all table-driven, so if you don't like all the codes, which I really don't, it's easy to rewrite them. And it's basically the same idea. Any number of bits transitioning to no bits is the strobe. It's still intrinsically slow, much slower than a standard QWERTY keyboard, because you know you got rollover on a QWERTY keyboard. You can come off one while going for another, do little licks like that. The thing I'm finding with this is that it's acceptable. I can do about 35 words a minute when I'm really on a roll and feeling strong. But that's slow. That's like half my normal typing speed, so it bugs me. The solution is really nice. I got this piece of software called PRD Plus from Productivity Software in New York. And this is a macro system. It lets you store up to something like 8,000 RAM resident macros. It's a TSR, runs in a DOS machine. So it lives in the heads-up display system. So if the path, if I'm typing on Microsoft Word in the Mac, is actually to have the bad keyboard talking to this processor. and then in this code, all of these very frequently used phrases are given macros. So if I use the word on the road, for example, is a frequent phrase. So OTR is on the road. So I type OTR and then any spacer delimiter, the OTR goes away and it's replaced by on the road with matching capitalization. And all the states are Alaska's AK dash and so on. So you end up with incredible speed. And if I'm doing straight text, then normal sorts of things, the data rate is on the order of 100 words a minute. Effective data rate. So, but of course it would be twice that if I was using a standard keyboard. So it's still slower than a standard keyboard, but it just takes the sting out. So, yeah.
Transmitting or receiving or both video on this thing?
I can transmit and receive video through the ham radio, ATV. That's not something I can do commercially because it is amateur radio, but it's a vestigial sideband transceiver.
I thought you said that you were sitting in this restaurant looking out of view and you knew that this kid was coming out skateboard.
No, I could see him out the window. He couldn't see me because I'm back inside the restaurant.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
How many bugs are
Oh, as the complexity of a system approaches infinity, the MTBF approaches zero. So yes, sure there are some. And yeah, it's not done, it never will be, and there are things that aren't right yet. But I wish I knew the answer to that question. Yeah?
Do you have any problems with sort of cognitive overload, like here you are, you read this great article, or in car goes past, you don't see something, or you're just too busy doing too many things?
Safety is always the highest priority. It kind of feels like operating a big windowing system. You know what I mean? Okay, I'm riding along, and reality is rude. And then here's a little window with a DOS system in it, and here's a little one on my left eye with a Mac in it. And so I see those at about the same place, and I don't have this blocking my view. It's down here in binocular mode, so I've still got peripheral vision and all the level zero interrupts of incoming trucks and things. I mean, there's various other little iconified things all over the place. There's even a little circular window up here that is reality behind me. My only complaint about all of this is that if reality is very boring at the moment, like Kansas, and I would like to compress it to a sub-window. like two-up page layout or something, and then you could have the road down here in this little window.
So the answer is no, you don't find yourself suddenly rolling over a can.
No, not really. They're very different sorts of things. Riding the bike is this kind of intuitive, physical, visceral activity. The real answer to your question is, on the open road, no, because there's a difference between the intuitive movement of the bike and the intellectual movement and the subtle fingertip movements. If I'm in a city or if I'm forced to deal with lots of inputs like signs and decisions and traffic, then I find that my data rate goes to about zero.
Okay.
And now I just have a habit of just shutting all that stuff down if I'm trying to deal with traffic and difficult situations.
Okay.
So, yeah.
First of all, I have tried to deal with Southern cops and email. It is impossible. Do you have drone crosswinds?
Not seriously. I don't know whether it's just because I'm so massy or whether it's a little slipperier now sideways than it used to. Really brutal, gusty crosswinds can be unpleasant, but I don't have too much of a problem with that. Nowhere near as much as on a regular bike. On an upright bike, you've got a very high CG, you're kind of fragile, and most your center of thrust, so to speak, is the wind load against your body, which is way up above the relatively transparent things down below. So it's, you do a lot of this kind of dicey stuff on an upright bicycle.
Where is your center? I
don't know. It feels nice and low and stable. I know when the bike's sitting here by itself, it certainly isn't. I mean, if we started to push it over, it wouldn't have to go very far before it'd be out of control. But when I'm sitting on it, it's very comfortable and solid feeling. Yeah.
Changing tires?
It's unpleasant.
Yeah.
I keep Kevlar webbing now, this sort of yellow mesh between tube and tire, which helps a lot. And to change the rear tire, which is the worst, I find a couple pieces of 2x4 or bricks, and I lift the whole bike up and let the landing gear sit on them. and that creates a service stand. For the front, I find a curb or something that's about half the diameter of that 16-inch wheel, 8 inches. Then I can lift the bike up, drop the quick release, and then just set it on something tall. And my camping stool happens to be about the same height as the trailer frame, so I can use it as a service stand.
Do you have a brake on the trailer?
Not yet, and it needs one. Yeah, that's one of those projects that's been on the list for a long time. There's a company in somewhere in Michigan, it doesn't matter, who offered to do surge brakes for me based on Magura hydraulics. And one of these days, I'll definitely got to do it on the kayak because I'm going to have this relatively lightweight recumbent pulling it, and then this ship behind me as a trailer. It's got to have its own brake. So it's really, I've been getting away with it, but I don't consider braking to be adequate right now. I've got a disc brake, hydraulic disc there, a hydraulic rim brake on the front, and the parking brake. And at the moment, that's it. So, yeah.
You talked about getting into this because you were spending more and more time working for things you didn't want.
Here it comes.
Three and a half years on this bike that you've ridden 1,000 miles. Are you feeling like that you're sliding back into the old way again?
Yeah, actually, I'm thinking my next midlife career change. I was thinking of doing something really radical, like getting a house in suburbia. A little bit. In fact, that's one of the things that's motivated this move to the water is that on the first two bikes, the original ones certainly, I mean, this thing absolutely owned my fantasies. It's all I thought about. I mean, I'd go to the bathroom with an atlas under my arm, you know, it was a constant obsession. And with the second bike, very much so, because I was sharing it with Maggie and I had this new relationship going, and also that was really computerizing it for real. So both of those were very motivating. This one, the motivation was almost more technological, it was more intellectual process. And I was thinking of all the neat things I could do to the bike, and I never really thought about maps, and I never really thought about where I was going. And so that should have been a clue, that the obsession was more getting all these things to work than actually schlepping it around up hills. I'm finding now with the idea of moving to the water, I'm getting that old wanderlust again, and I'm back to the fantasies and studying charts and learning about navigation and reading everything I can. And you know, that's really the motive, is the intensity of learning curves and things that represent new horizons. So it's, yes, that's very much a problem, and it's very much in the process of being fixed. So you hear it. Okay.
Still with Maggie?
Was there still what?
Still with Maggie?
No.
Maggie and Abraham.
We're still good friends. We're still in pretty much daily email contact. She lives in the Santa Cruz Mountains now and is probably going to be doing sailing for a couple months this winter and is kind of off on different adventures. Actually, we diverged last year. We went to Iowa together, rode for a while with the knowledge that we were going to kind of diverge our paths. And then in Joliet, Illinois, she turned south and went toward Ohio with the cat on her trailer and cat carrier. And then I headed north. So there are openings in nomadic research labs.
How
serious is it? Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't have a way of measuring grades accurately. I know I can do 12% grades if I'm patient and something very close above that, I think, would stop me. There are roads I definitely avoid. One of the first pieces of advice I got when I started all this was this old-timer named Robbie, who actually had the first recumbent I ever saw. And we were kind of having dinner once before I was hitting the road, and he said, "Steve, let me give you a piece of advice. Never turn onto a road with mount or hill in its name." So, unfortunately, not all roads that are hilly tell you that they're hilly. Sometimes they're very innocent-sounding. And so the solution, of course, is high-tech. We take the GPS receiver, the terrain database of the U.S., make a wireframe model of it, and display it on the screen, and then I'll be able to look at, that looks bad, so I'll go there. Let's see, right back there, I believe. Yes?
Could you describe kayak again?
What do you want to know about it?
Well, you told us it's got this big thing behind it.
Okay, basically, it would be like a folding sea kayak. Not the folding kayak like Feathercraft and Kleppers and things, actually, are a aluminum frame with skin over it, but actually rigid glass Kevlar kayak. But you can cut the thing in half and put bulkheads in and bolt them together that way. So it's, and then you can unbolt them and then take the whole thing and hinge it over. So it's just shorter. The main reason for that is a 20-foot trailer behind a bicycle is going to be really weird on the road. So it may be weird anyway, but I mean, it's, you know, it's sort of weird. And then to do the amphibian stuff, I'll just unfold a recumbent, not this big, but just a normal recumbent bicycle that'll stash somewhere on the boat. And then basically other than that, it's just all the same kind of thing. The tools aren't to let me work and communicate while I'm mobile. So, yeah.
I'm not too familiar with recumbents. I'm just wondering how standard is this frame?
This is a custom. It follows the lineage of the Avatar, the Ryan, the Infinity, the basic long wheelbase, low handlebar. And there are many who have done this. This is not my invention. The trouble is I couldn't find one that was robust enough to suit my needs. And so I said, oh, well, I'll build one. So I got some tubing and a torch, called myself a frame builder, and discovered that frame building is quite the art form. One of those things you can eventually get good at, but not on your first one. And it did, in fact, kind of hold together. But then I took it to see a real frame builder, Jack Trumbull of Franklin Frames in Columbus, and I showed it to him, and I said, you know, I wonder if you could help me with this. And he said, I think we should start over. That was a good decision because he had lots of experience with tandems, and that's where the big tube, the crossover drive, the triple stays, I mean, the steering geometry is right on, you know, so it was good to do that.
Yes. Isn't there some way to incorporate this into your canoe instead of having to go out and get the paddles that you have to take your hands off of? Can't you incorporate the same handlebar you're carrying the bike anyway? Isn't there some way to get it to give you...
Yes, that's actually the first approach to this. I was thinking of making it a pedal-powered kayak, which actually a lot of people in the human-powered vehicle community have done that. I haven't totally gotten away from that idea yet. There are a couple problems, and the dynamics of a sea kayak kind of require a lot of body English and a very tight coupling between body and bike, or body and boat. You know, like if you go over, I was rolling the other day up in the waters off the coast of Maine. Believe me, don't want to spend a whole lot of time in the water where it's thick. God, it's cold. And you need to be so tightly coupled to the thing that you can just do a hip snap and flip the thing up right side up. Well, to have enough space in there to accommodate a drivetrain, that requires a lot of leg clearance, and I think the whole thing might get too loose. Now, if it's a boat that's more intrinsically stable, like a catamaran or something, I could do that. Then it gets a little big for the road, and also creates problems with wind loading and things like that, since it's human power. So that's some really tough trade-offs. People have done some very effective racing machines that way. They're relatively special purpose, but for open-ended touring, it has to be able to handle a variety of conditions. So I'm not sure that's the right answer, but that's how it seems to me at the moment. The other thing is that it may be possible to put in some small pedals or even sliders, almost like the rudder pedals, but give them a different mode. I wouldn't expect that to be efficient enough for propulsion, but it may be able to run a generator, charge a battery, which along with the solar panels and AC charger could also run a little trolling motor. So I can get away from the paddle now, and then if it's sunny, or if I just feel like generating power a different way, and then use those systems in my hands. So the design's not nailed yet. Decisions. Okay, go. Yeah. Go ahead.
Thanks. I was wondering, what's the most hair-raising thing that's happened to you
in Never mind. This question. That question. That was it. Wow. There's at least one moment of pure terror a day. In fact, I've been on the market for heat-seeking missiles that I can the tailpipe. Gosh, I'm trying to decide whether to tell you this story or not. There's one of the stories in the book about an encounter with in the Maryland wood. I'll tell you what. I'm going to have sort of a disclaimer here. This is a mixed audience. I don't know you people very well, so I'm going to have to clean up the language dramatically, but use your imaginations. I was on the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal. I was on the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal towpath, and I was heading east. And there's a little area in the towpath. This runs along the Cumberland, runs along the Potomac River for 184 miles. It's a wonderful place to go. Mostly, this doesn't happen to you if you go there. There's this area where it runs parallel to Interstate 70, and I looked across this big clearing at the interstate, and I could see that there was cops and traffic all snarled up, and then I looked a little closer and saw that there was... I heard a crack. It scared me. The semi, there had been an accident with a truck, and the semi had broken apart and rolled down the hill, and it was all split open with boxes all over the landscape. It was clear that there was some very major accident happened here. So I stopped and just kind of, wow, what a contrast, because I was on this peaceful little path, and it could have been out of a Bambi movie, you know, it was wonderful. The Potomac River off to my right, and there's deer, and it's a beautiful fall day. So I'm taking a handful of gorp and eating and taking a water bottle sip, and I heard this rustling of the leaves behind me. And five of the biggest, meanest, toughest-looking men I've ever seen in my life stepped out of the woods. I said, hello. And one was this giant. He said, what the hell is this? I said, oh, it's a bicycle. It's kind of like a race, so I got to go now. The other guy said, you got a gun on that thing, man? I said, nah, no gun. I thought about it and thought that would just get me in trouble. He said, I heard that. You don't be messing with no gun. I'll get you 15 years in Maryland. Just ask me. So what are you guys doing here anyway? And this big, burly redhead and long ponytail says, oh, we're convicts from the federal penitentiary up in Hagerstown. I said, are you escaping or what? And he just started to tell me, and then the big guy is this giant. He's like my height, but twice the size and all muscle. He put his hand on my shoulder and says, I think we ought to fix our travel man up here, don't you? I walked with them off into the woods a little bit toward the truck wreck. I figured there's somehow some correlation here. There's people over there. We'll go that way. We passed this yellow prison truck with an armed guard sitting on the hood. And I turned around and said, you guys that work for these crews? I said, you got it. We're here to clean up that truck. So we kept walking, though. We didn't go to the truck. We instead went off into the woods, and there was this clearing. And back in the clearing was this giant lumpy mound about the height of the trailer, maybe. And it was like this old musty tarp. And he said, our stash, man, the truck was full of this. I thought, great, they've been stealing stuff off the truck. They're going to share it with him and be living with these guys soon. Televisions, roller bearings, powder pins, that's it. No, so he pulled the tarp back, and underneath was a giant mound of Sara Lee pastries. And he reached down, he picked up, he handed me this box, it has a walnut cake. This is excellent. Is this man going to be messing with no damn walnut cake? Come on, cheese Danish. That's so, before long, I get this armload of Sara Lee pastries while these murderers and bank robbers are all arguing. Finally, we made our way back to the bike. I said, look, I can't carry all this. Well, we got to the bike, and they're plucking the stuff out of my hands and shoving it under bungee cords. And the bike was festooned with pastries. Finally, we said goodbye, and I hit the road, and I lived on those things for week at least. So I met a lot of strange people on the trip. I think the convicts take the cake. Yeah.
There are a lot of bicyclists in the room, and I think they'd be interested in your lighting setup.
Ah, yes. Well, you saw the one on the helmet.
Yeah,
when I was feeling lightheaded, there's a spot in flood up here. This makes me look like a roving hole in the road here. There's a very nice light. I just put aluminum foil in the front to reflect it all backwards, and it's a nice 7-inch reflector. And no, I didn't steal it. I'm sorry, I know. I should have. I'm embarrassed. There's a big monster headlight up here, 4-inch steel beam quartz halogen that is 30 watts or something. It's fairly serious. And then back in the back, where nobody's going to be able to see it, there's taillights, and these are the best part. I made them out of high-brightness LEDs, and there are two clusters of 14 LEDs at 3 candela each. The clusters are slightly brighter than a normal automotive taillight at 1/6 the power. A normal automotive taillight gets hot, so you don't care about the heat, so all that energy is wasted. And then it's got all these other wavelengths that you don't want, so you filter out everything except the red. And this little bit of energy that finally makes it back where you're aiming it is what you get for your 330 milliamps. So I prefer to just make red light. It really works well. Yes?
What's your power consumption when you have everything turned on?
I never do. It's an active power management where things are only on when they're relevant. So when it's on in sort of normal use, the bicycle control processor is running, Mac is on, radios are on, an amp or so. I usually have a positive power budget. 1.2 amps is fairly common. If I'm on the radio, that brings it up to about, that's another amp all by itself. This drives about 3, so I run it fairly occasionally. The normal use, I just turn it on and send and receive the mail. But there's a panic line that comes out of that, and I can yank that to ground, and it'll fire up the system and send a panic message via the bridge up back to San Diego, and that's staffed 24 hours a day. So. But I guess to answer your question, there really is no answer to that. It would change too much.
Can you describe a little more just what the power system is? You know, I think a battery.
Oh yeah, right. I didn't say that much, did I? At the moment, there are three sealed beam cords. There are three sealed starved electrolytes, sealed lead acid batteries. There's a 72 watt solar panel that charges them, and an 8 amp resonant power supply, a switcher that can talk to it. There are Hall effect sensors on the input and output of the batteries, you know, from the charge bus and then out to the load bus, so the trailer control processor can look at all the loads and then give me a status display of what the power situation looks like. And there's a solar charge manager to keep the batteries from frying. So I tried to make it as simple and bomb-proof as I could. I didn't want it to depend upon computers being alive for the batteries to be maintained, because computers aren't always alive. In fact, even using the computers for power management is interesting, because unless you keep an internal model of it with some dedicated piece of hardware, the computer's image of the battery state tends to diverge from reality, which is one of my reasons for being lazy and using lead acids, because they're easy. But I want to switch to nickel hydride so they get big enough. Much better power density.
You're talking about making a kayak the next thing. What are you going to do with this?
starting the bid at $10,000? I don't know yet. Smithsonian actually expressed interest in it a few years ago, but I was writing it at the time. Are we running out of time?
Well, you know, why don't we see if there are people who have questions they must ask. Don't forget there are refreshments next door, and there'll be a chance, though I hope we give Steve a chance to recover, relax a little bit first, maybe. But are there any questions that people feel they must ask that can't wait?
Yes.
How long is that tube underneath your seat?
Ah, a cheap way to make a waterproof case for an Atlas, PVC. That was easy, yes.
Have you written technical papers about this one?
Yeah, yeah, that's a good question. I have an alias that Carl's going to handle. I've been publishing notes from the bike lab via the internet for quite a while now, and it's very detailed technical reports. All the archives are in ftp.telebit.com in the pub nomad subdirectory. ftp.telebit.com. And look under /pub/nomad. And it's all the archives of the bike. There's technical reports, about a megabyte of road stories, some GIFs, archives of the Technomad's alias. I have a discussion group for people who are nomadic and using technology to stay in communication. Internet's very much home. Anyway, I've just added you all to the distribution list for the notes from the bike lab, and Carl will set up a local redistribution or reflector list, or do something with it so you get it. I'm not sure.
I'll post to B-board the address of the...
Well, why don't we give thanks to Steve.
With me, I brought about 8 or 10 in only, but they're more back at the hotel. They're $11 each, and you can subscribe to the journal for 15. So, thanks a lot. It's really been a pleasure.